The koala is one of Australia's most loved animals. With its big fluffy ears and black button nose, it's adored by all. Though cute, koalas are thought to be lazy and slow on the uptake. But once you scratch the surface, there's much more to their world than meets the eye. Communication, conflict, and even deception occur inside the usually secret world of a koala colony. With that world becoming ever more fragmented from urban encroachment, it's a society that is now under threat. 200 years ago, millions of koalas lived across Australia's eucalypt forests. Today, an estimated 50,000 remain. There's a turf war going on, and the koalas are losing. But as we move in on their territory, can koalas continue to live their slow life in the fast lane? Brisbane is a rapidly expanding city. It's home to 2 million people, with nearly 1,000 more moving here every week. But in the outskirts of this subtropical city are some of the best eucalypt forests in Australia. These provide refuge to countless animal species. People are the newcomers here, and they are competing with animals for the same real estate. On a typical Brisbane morning in July, residents go about their daily business. But the locals are unaware that a silent witness shares the suburbs. A female koala has also made this neighbourhood her home. This is the boundary where the world of people and koalas collide. Inside these small urban pockets of forest, koala society can be a place of high drama. For a female in the suburbs, the attention from male koalas can be exhausting because they are after one thing, sex. The female is not interested and does her best to reject the young upstart. When the alpha male sees her messing around with a rival, there's trouble. Weighing in at a burly 10 kilos, this alpha male is the strongest, most powerful koala in the colony. He has earned his place through sheer brute force. And now he's coming to flex his muscles. He makes sure the rival male is put back in his place. Asserting his dominance, he maintains the right to mate with this female. The loser retreats to the sidelines. Dominance can change quickly. It's a fine line between being today's alpha male and tomorrow's outcast. Calm returns to the colony, and the koalas go back to the business of browsing on gum leaves. Gum leaves are highly toxic, and this noxious diet was once believed to send the koalas into a drunken state, hallucinating from toxic compounds high in the trees. But lethargy is merely an energy-saving adaptation to their poor diet. It takes a lot of work to chew a leaf, and koalas need to eat for 4 hours a day to get enough calories. And this female is eating for two. Nestled in her pouch is a six-month-old Joey, who occasionally ventures outside. For the last 6 months, the baby has been suckling milk from the teats inside his mother's pouch. But now, in readiness for eating leaves, he must consume her feces. For these contain pap, a secretion that gives him the bacteria needed to digest tough eucalyptus leaves. The Joey is keen to explore his new world. He communicates to his mother with squeaks and murmurs. He will stay by her side until he's a year old. By then, he'll be smart to the ways of koala society and streetwise enough to navigate the suburbs. But for now, he must be content with hanging out on mum. In this patch of forest in the Brisbane suburb of Petrie, biologists from Griffith University have been studying the movement of koalas for 2 years. Catherine Dexter and David Black want to understand the social dynamics within a koala colony that's surrounded by the suburbs.
We track the animals weekly, trying to get an understanding of how far they're moving and how they're interacting. One of the things that we're trying to do is capture more koalas and put collars on them to track their movements.
Okay, that looks like we've got him.
Let me just take a GPS.
Yep, can you take that? Can you just check some of the details for me?
Yep.
All right, so can you see the rump?
Yep, the rump's good.
So good? Okay. And the, can you see the coat?
Yep.
You
know, yeah, the coat's fine, the eye's fine. Okay. The koala's very active.
The next step is to snare this koala to add him to their study. So a team of expert catchers has been called in. They use a pole to coax the koala down from the tree.
Yeah, I can pass it up to you. I'll bring him down. Bring him back to you. Yeah. Bring him down. Just bring it down.
Beautiful.
Okay. Nice. Good, well done. Well done. Okay, quick.
Hang on. Put it over his head. Put it over his head.
Just right here. Okay.
Nice work, Dave. Nice work.
Good catch,
Debbie. Well done on that branch. Nice, well done.
Each and every one of our koalas, which is now over 70 for this project, have a full health check at the beginning. We give the animal a light sedative. So once it's asleep, we pop the new collar on.
We collar koalas because we want to track them. When we catch them, we put either a VHF or a GPS collar on them. So they'll have every 4-hour fixes. And this gives us a really clear indication of how they're moving without having to track them every day.
One of the nice things about this project is naming the koalas, and we have a little bit of fun with that. So the names that have come up are rock stars or movie stars.
They've called this koala Hendrix, after the legendary guitarist.
So once the collar is fitted, we take it back to the tree that we caught it in and release it. Once we're able to download the data, it gives us the information of where that animal's moved over the past 4.5 months.
Here we go. Good luck, fella.
For me personally, to be involved in a project like this, which is going to have major outcomes, road mitigation, that's enormously satisfying.
It's now September and change is in the air. It's the start of the breeding season and the alpha male is restless. His testosterone levels are rising and he's staying close to the female. The rival male keeps his distance because he doesn't want another fight. But there's movement below. An outsider has entered the colony, so the alpha male decides to investigate. The intruder is a young 4-year-old travelling male, a wanderer who has left his native colony to try his luck with females elsewhere. But he's not welcome here. When there's conflict, koalas talk to each other to avoid a fight. The alpha male reacts to the arrival of a travelling male with a guttural bellow. It's his way of saying, "I'm the boss, get out of my territory." And the intruder replies, "Yeah, make me." But the alpha male is having none of it. He bellows harder. Though not much larger than a cat, he sounds as big as a lion. The intimidation tactic seems to have worked. The traveller decides to move on. But there's more than one male in this colony. These two males embark on a different form of communication. First, the traveller smears his scent on the tree, hoping this odour will intimidate the other males and attract females. Adult males have a scent patch on their chest, which they use to mark their territory. The resident male replies by scent marking back. Once the traveller catches a whiff of the resident male's scent, he realises retreat is probably the best option. But travelling males don't give up easily, and as darkness descends on the forest patch, the traveller bides his time and prepares to mount a surprise attack. Under the cover of night, the travelling male returns to the colony to challenge the alpha male to a duel. The alpha male forces the intruder to the end of the branch. Far from cute and cuddly, the alpha male turns feral and the fur flies. ...96% of all male-to-male encounters result in both males backing off, but not this time. The intruder has no choice but to retreat to the end of the branch and accept he has lost this battle. The alpha male declares victory with an almighty bellow. He wants all the koalas in the colony to know he is still king. Similar battles for koala dominance are being played out in patches of bush throughout Queensland suburbia. The language of koalas had been a mystery until two biologists from the University of Queensland delved deeper into its meaning. In order to crack the code of koala communication, Dr. Bill Ellis and Dr. Sean Fitzgibbon conduct an unusual experiment.
The koala social system seems to be a lot more complex than we might have otherwise thought. The question really was, who are koalas bellowing to? Are they advertising? Are they trying to ward other males off? What exactly is going on with koala bellowing?
Yeah, we've got one, Bill, up here.
We were attracted to this particular spot because we heard a bellow.
It seemed like a useful tool, recording an individual's bellows and playing them back to find out under what circumstances a koala might respond to a bellow.
For this experiment, Bill and Sean are joined by British acoustic biologist Dr. Ben Charlton. The idea is to play back the guttural calls of male koalas to a female and compare her reaction to each. The first sound played is the bellow from a small male koala.
This is going to be playback one, and it's going to be a small male.
A head turn is a good response as far as the scientists are concerned. Next, they play a bellow from a large male to see what response they get. She seems impressed. Looks like she wants to get to know the owner of this bellow a little bit better. Moving towards the sound suggests that female koalas can gauge characteristics of the male from their bellow.
That's very strong.
We are pretty sure now that the bellow is an individual signature of each male. There's components in the bellow that indicate how big the male is. And so we think that probably females are able to select large individual males simply by their bellow.
But the love serenade is over once a dog arrives. Self-preservation is more important than curiosity and romance. Koalas are found almost exclusively along Australia's east coast. 200 years ago, koala habitat was abundant, but today it is so fragmented that koalas cling on in isolated pockets. Only a few survive in the outer suburbs of Melbourne and Sydney. Brisbane is the last big city where they're found in numbers. The Petrie Science Study site in northern Brisbane highlights a patchwork effect of forest and suburbs. Any koala that ventures out of the bush here ends up on the streets. And on their tail are biologists Catherine Dexter and David Black.
We get them sitting in people's backyards where you just wouldn't think that they'd want to live. You think they generally should be based in the bush, but we find them quite frequently out in the suburbs. They've ranged quite away from where they should be.
This show was created for you and your family to watch together. Welcome to Nat Geo Wild.
David has been collecting home video footage from residents who've come into contact with koalas in the suburbs. And some of what they've seen is rather bizarre.
I really find it fascinating how the koalas are relating to the suburbs. I've seen koalas in backyards where dogs have killed koalas before. Really heartbreaking. In the suburbs, you see really strange behaviours. You'll see them in really strange trees and going through backyards of houses. There's so many risks that they're taking to go into this suburban environment. You really get a feeling for how threatened they are in their everyday life.
Living in the city comes with its challenges. Koalas may have started life in the slow lane, but freeways now intersect their bushland home. Over one third of all koala deaths in southeast Queensland are from vehicle impact. The Griffith University biologists are helping koalas to move freely without having to interact with busy roads. They're planting trees on bridges to link koala corridors and adapting underpasses to encourage koalas to go under the roads.
Cars are the number one direct killer of koalas. The fundamental question we're trying to answer is, do koalas use underpasses that have been developed for them?
We really need to get visual proof that they were crossing these structures. So we set up cameras at every possible location that they could be crossing. I had no expectation, but I mean, it would be fantastic to see a koala, but such a long shot.
It's early morning in the colony, and the koalas are in no hurry to join the rush hour. Mother and baby are enjoying their tucker. Now 9 months old, the joey spends much of its time eating gum leaves. He carefully sniffs each leaf and stalk to avoid the most toxic. Koalas have a keen sense of smell and are quite finicky about which leaves to eat. The joey still relies on his mother for milk and will regularly pop his head back in the pouch for drink. At this age, he becomes quite adventurous and will wander away from mum to explore the new world. But there are many scary sights and sounds nearby. So he decides it's best to be by his mother's side, where it feels safe and warm. By late spring, storm clouds are brewing. It's the beginning of the severe weather season in southeast Queensland. This time of year, 100 millimetres of rain can fall in a single day, drenching the koala colony. The fur on the koala's bottom is densely packed to provide a cushion for the hard branches and insulation from the wet and the cold. Once the rain stops, Mother and Joey need to eat to make up for lost time. Koalas spend only 5 hours a day being active and 19 hours a day resting or sleeping, so every waking minute counts. Feeding is always the highest priority, come rain or shine. As the sea of suburbia spreads, the koala's habitat is reduced to small islands of bush. The travelling male will never experience the native bush that his ancestors knew. Instead, he will contend with all the stresses of living within the urban sprawl. Travelling koalas are known to roam for up to 10 kilometres to find another colony. But in suburbia today, the remaining gum trees needed for food can be few and far between. And to make matters worse, the travelling male has unwittingly stumbled into another male's territory. The resident male isn't keen on visitors at all. He makes sure the traveller knows he's not welcome in his patch. Jungles still apply even in an urban jungle, and males must confront each other to sort out the pecking order. The traveller has been cast out once more. He crosses the creek to get away from the occupied territory. He's not particularly elegant in the water, as his body is actually designed for climbing trees, but he can dog paddle his way to safety. He's persistent for good reason. While alpha males dominate in size, chances are the traveller will find females by stealth, if he can sneak under the radar. Biologists Catherine and David have often seen territorial disputes play out amongst the koalas that they've been studying. A few months ago, they were tracking two koalas. One was the young male Hendrix that they put a collar on a few months ago, and the other was an alpha male called James. Their pecking order was very clear. James had access to the best trees and was preventing Hendrix from using them. Then everything changed. James became diseased and so was caught and taken to an animal hospital where he remained for 2.5 months. While James was absent, Hendrix took over his territory. When James was eventually released back into the wild, he was immediately pushed out of the forest by Hendrix and forced to live in the suburbs.
The interesting thing is now Hendrix, who was the young challenger, was now sitting in trees where James had once sat. Obviously, James had to find somewhere else to go. He's had to cross quite a number of roads and negotiate fences, dogs, all sorts of things. It was only a couple of weeks ago and he was still sitting in that backyard.
The significance of this discovery is that it shows how quickly colony dynamics change when a dominant male is removed or incapacitated by disease. And disease is something the biologists are seeing more and more of. Chlamydia, the predominantly sexually transmitted disease, is rampant in the koala populations across Queensland. Now it appears Mighty Hendrix has succumbed.
We're going to try the other one now?
Yeah, we'll
sick one?
We'll just go look at it first and then we'll see.
So when we find a diseased koala, we try our hardest to capture it as quickly as possible and get it to Australia Zoo Wildlife Hospital, because that will give it the best chance of surviving. Yeah, he's looking fine.
So 119
he is. It's a pretty distressing situation because you become attached to those animals and you know that you have to do something about it.
I just sort of give him a general quick check over.
We check the condition of the animal, check the coat, the eyes.
Oh, it's breathing and that was at 94.
The other thing that we do is a body score, and that's done by checking the back at the shoulder blades there, making sure that there's a nice sort of thickness in the muscle there, and that generally gives you an indication of how healthy that animal is.
Lucky for Hendrix, he was found to have only a mild case of chlamydia and was treated and returned within a fortnight before James had a chance to reinvade his old stomping ground. Left untreated, chlamydia can cause conjunctivitis and blind the animal. It can also lead to wet bottom, a urinary tract infection that discolours the fur on the koala's rear. A new vaccine for chlamydia is being trialled and it's hoped that this will reduce the spread of the disease. Chlamydia often spreads through the koala population by sexual activity. But regardless of the threat of disease, when the female is in estrus and in the mood, there's little stopping treetop romance. Throwing her head back and forwards may be a sign that the female is now ovulating. Mating only lasts a few minutes and then the male is off. Male koalas play no role in parenting. Other males are hanging around, but their chances of getting lucky are thwarted in more ways than one. Apart from guarding the female from the advances of other suitors, he has secreted a gelatinous plug that glues her genital tract together. A final attempt to ensure she becomes pregnant with his young. The breeding habits of koalas are being studied by biologists Dr. Bill Ellis and Dr. Sean Fitzgibbon. And recently they made an important discovery.
The surprising thing that we found was that large resident males within the population were only siring about 50% of the offspring. You had these transient males that tended to come and go, and lo and behold, it was these transient males that were siring the offspring at our site.
Yeah, I wonder if the other boys know you're here, eh?
Yeah, a few pouch young around, he could be the proud owner of some of them.
The transient or travelling male is important for maintaining genetic diversity, especially in areas where overcrowding and inbreeding occurs. This is one of the big problems for koalas in the suburbs. At Coomera on the Gold Coast, a new suburb has been built around a small remnant of bushland. In this forest patch, as many as 15 koalas live inside an area that would normally support only a few. Phil and Sean studied six of these koalas and followed their movements for 4 months to see how they were affected by overcrowding. Like Catherine and David's study, they found males were being pushed out of the forest and onto the surrounding streets.
There's just not enough space in there for the koalas that need to live in this area. Now, if there's that many koalas crammed into a small area, they're under a lot more pressure, which explains why in some of these crowded, isolated fragments, we do see a lot of disease.
One of the koalas that Bill and Sean tracked was a mature male called Houdini.
So this is where we were earlier. You can see he's definitely come through one of these fences.
Houdini occupied a small patch of trees between a road and some houses and then tried to move into the central bush area. But it was already crowded, so the resident male koalas prevented Houdini from entering not once, but four times. So Houdini was forced to settle for a life in the median strip.
Briefly, it looks like, but by and large, he's just hanging in that tiny little patch there.
Yeah.
Koalas obviously have a really complex social system, and I think there's no doubt that what we're doing in their environment is breaking that system down.
The Joey is now a year old and getting too big to carry for long. He's becoming increasingly curious and is happy to wander away from mum to explore for hours on end. He's almost fully independent now. His mother is not producing milk anymore and won't suckle him again. So he has to rely on gum leaves, but he's not yet that good at getting them down his throat. Like his mother, he will survive exclusively on eucalyptus leaves throughout his expected lifespan of 12 years. Four kilometres away from Petrie is the Bruce Highway. It's the main freeway in Queensland. It's hard to believe that a koala would ever try to cross such a busy road, but that's what biologists Catherine Dexter and David Black have come to investigate.
One of the things that we understand about roads is that they're barriers, and you would suspect a six-lane highway to be a major barrier to an animal.
OK, yep. He's in the foot of that tree there.
So close to that road.
Well, they don't seem to have any sort of concept of a busy road to a non-busy road. They seem to be driven to go in a direction, and they just go.
They've tracked the intrepid Captain Bogart close to this bustling spot and are now retracing his steps to understand how he arrived at this place.
So, yeah, with Captain Bogart, so once we were able to get his GPS collar off, download the data and understand his movements, we were really able to see that he'd done this massive walk.
The tracking data reveals Captain Bogart roamed around a patch of bush next to a major intersection on the Bruce Highway. Then he went over a busy overpass going to and fro, crossing it no less than five times. But the travelling male's journey didn't end there. He walked along the highway for 1.5 kilometres, then did something no one believed was possible. He crossed the highway, all six lanes of it. This is a truly amazing feat for a tree-dwelling animal.
When I first saw this, I couldn't believe what was happening. I was like, that's just insane. We didn't think that they would try to cross a six-lane highway.
I don't think anyone's ever seen that sort of interaction with roads and major roads, and how lucky he's been to actually be able to survive all of that.
2 months ago, Catherine and David installed spy cameras inside a local underpass to find out whether koalas were using it. Today, they discover the results.
So I got the images back from our tech guy, Rob. This is like all the images of the underpass using the scout guide cameras.
Okay.
First one. Oh, yeah.
Ibis.
Yeah.
Very nice. Galena. The quality is actually really good.
Yeah, it's not bad. Something at night.
Wallaby.
You can see its tail there. Holy.
I think
it's definitely a koala. Okay.
Go next.
Oh my God.
This is amazing. You know what this means? I actually think we have got the first ever recorded pictures, of a koala using a retrofitted underpass.
Now that we've actually had confirmation, we can start retrofitting other areas where we know koalas are crossing.
The work that we've done is going to have some really long-term implications for koalas to allow them to be able to live in harmony with people.
Today is a big day for one little koala. The Joey has reached the first stage of adulthood and is now 13 months old. His mother lets him know with a friendly bite that the time has come for him to stop relying on her. It It's time to expand his horizons and find out what the world is like across the street. Mum watches as if to say goodbye. He'll remain within his mother's home range for at least the next year. Not used to navigating his way at street level, he stumbles into a backyard. It's a strange place with exotic plants and alarming sounds. He heads for high ground. Depending on how strong he grows over the next few years, he will either become a traveller continually wandering the streets or an alpha male that rises through the ranks of koala society. As long as there is still a colony in the neighbourhood for him to conquer. By the end of summer, the koala's mating season is drawing to a close. For 6 months, the males have been working out their place in the pecking order, and the prize is to mate with a female. But the alpha male stays close to her, and his intention is clear. The tenderness between them is over. Now that she's pregnant, she's no longer interested in sex, and she's taken to rejecting him. Against all odds, the travelling male has made it back to the colony. He senses the weakness in the alpha male and seizes the opportunity to challenge him for control of the domain. He's been waiting for this moment all breeding season, and he's not holding back. Is forced to relinquish his dominance to the new champion. The traveller has triumphed at last. He's earned the right to mate with this female. His resilience has kept him alive and allowed him to rise to the top of the koala society. Only the toughest survive life in suburbia. Koalas have adapted to the changes that we humans have created. But with fewer wild stretches of koala habitat left in Queensland, urbanisation is the reality koalas will face. Whether the koala can continue this tenuous existence, only time will tell.